I actually told him he could have some minutes of Russell's time. Russell forgot and sang all of his songs, so I still get all my time. If you would, let's go ahead and pray for the Spanish work and Andy's work together. Our great God, our Heavenly Father, we are truly blessed to have a man like Andy with us, full of energy and zeal for the Hispanic and Anglo communities here in this town. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that through his work and the work here at West Hill, that the floodgates might be opened and that your word might spread throughout this community to those who are English speaking, to those who are Spanish speaking, to anyone who has an interest and love for you. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that these hearts might be mended and malleable to the word so that they might obey and come to know you and the grace and the mercy that you so freely offer. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will use Andy, that you will wear him out in your service as you do each one of us as we seek to save the lost. Give us each a heart of confidence and boldness to spread the word to all of those around, near and far. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thankful for the opportunity this morning to have gone to Frisco, Texas. They were having their spring lectureship, and they asked me to come and kick it off. And so I had got to spend some time in Frisco with our brethren up there. And it's kind of an exciting opportunity to be with Christians that you don't know. It was interesting. It was a congregation of a little over 100 people, and when they introduced me, they said that I was from Oklahoma. And there must have been 20 or more people come up to me afterward and say, "I'm from Oklahoma too." I didn't know Oklahoma was moving to Frisco. I didn't get that memo. But apparently there's a lot of people in Frisco, Texas from Oklahoma. The church there is thriving. It is very energized, and they've got a great preacher by the name of Todd Creighton. And I'd ask you to continue to pray for Frisco and for all of our sister congregations. We have a great opportunity set before each one of us. In fact, last week, the lesson that I did about Kingdom First Living is the theme of the Frisco lectureship. And I like that theme, and so I said, you know what, I'm going to preach those lessons. I may not preach the same lesson that Jeff Jenkins preaches. I'm sure mine won't be near as good as his, but when we come to that one, I'm going to preach that lesson too. You know, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33 to seek first the kingdom of God, and all of these things shall be added unto you. And we know in the context specifically that he was talking about the spiritual blessings and the physical blessings of this life. What we're going to eat, what we're going to drink, where we shall live, what we shall clothe ourselves with. These are the staples of life, the shelter of life. And God, it says, will provide when we prioritize. When we set our priority, God has promised, "I will come in and I will take care of you." We see that then as kingdom first living. We might call it Christian commitment. We might refer to it as dedication. There's all kinds of phrases that we might use to describe a life that is dedicated to walking the paths of God and putting him first and foremost in our lives. That's the concept of kingdom first living. And as with any of these, or any of these we might talk about, there is a certain look to it. And my goal is to get us to visualize what kingdom first living looks like, that we might then internalize what it is, and then we might epitomize it in our lives, so that others can see kingdom first living in us. When people look at you, when people look at your life, do they see someone who is putting the kingdom first, or someone who is trying to put some of the earth in with the kingdom? A little bit of self-potency, we might say, into what God has promised to us. What are they seeing when they look at us in our Christianity? Last week it was kingdom first living in our workplace, in our school, but what about kingdom first living as Christians? Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 3, beginning in verse 14, that I intend to come to you shortly, but if I'm delayed, I write these things so that you may know how you ought to behave yourself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the buttress of truth. In that verse, Paul identifies to Timothy the reason or the purpose for writing this letter, 1 Timothy. He says, I want you to know, if I don't get to come and tell you these things face to face, I want you to know how you ought to behave. The idea is not, you know, as we as parents, we have little children and we're trying to get them to sit still and behave. But we're talking about more the activities of Christianity. What does it look like when we behave as the household of God, the church of the living God? That's our question. What does Kingdom First living look like for the Christian? Well, what better place to go than to look at 1 Timothy? If Paul says, I'm writing this so that you'll know how to behave, well, let's look and see what he writes. When we are kingdom first living, number one, our life will be a life of war. I know we don't like to talk about conflict and fighting and war, but notice in verse 18, Paul says, this charge I entrust to you, Timothy, my child, in accordance with the prophecies previously made about you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, holding faith and a good conscience. If we look at the whole of chapter 1, he says, I left you there so that you can charge them not to teach certain things, so that you can combat false teachers. When we talk about the war that we're in, we know, Ephesians chapter 6, we are not engaged in a warfare against blood, against the flesh and blood, but we are engaged in a warfare against principalities and powers in high places. It is a spiritual warfare, not one that is... Hold on a second. Oh, come on, there's got to be... Excuse me, I'm sorry. Got it. When we engage in the spiritual warfare... I'm going to have to stop going to that nursing home singing because I can't preach after that one. That's a lot. When we look at the spiritual warfare, we know that we are not fighting against the flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. It is a spiritual warfare of the kind where we are seeking to stop the mouths of the gainsayers, those which would set themselves up against the truth. Notice in verse 7 of chapter 1, he talks about those who think that they know what they're talking about, but they don't. And they keep talking about things that they know nothing about. Notice, he says, desiring to be teachers of the law without understanding either what they are saying or the things about which they make confident assertions. When I read that verse, I'm almost immediately transported back to some of my college classes. When those that were opposed to those professors that were opposed to the Bible would begin to chastise, to chide, to taunt those who claim to be Christians. You believe in God, you believe in the Bible, and they make confident assertions about something they know nothing about. I had to stop watching the television shows about the mysteries of the Bible, or about the history of the Bible, or where's the lost 10 tribes of Israel, or what about the gospel according to Mary? And they interview these supposed scholars who don't even know what the books say. And they make confident assertions. And they know nothing about what they're talking. That's who we fight against. We fight against false teachers. We fight against sin in the church. Notice at beginning of verse 8, we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully, understanding this, that the law is not laid down for the just, but for the lawless, the disobedient, the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane, for those who strike their fathers and mothers, for murderers and sexually immoral, men who practice homosexuality, enslavers of men, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine in accordance with the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted. Paul says, look, we are out here to fight against the sin. The law was laid down to protect from sin, but men still engage in these awful, unlawful, immoral actions, and we are called to fight against them. Yes, fight against them. Wage the good warfare. Too often we start fighting amongst ourselves, though, and we lose sight of the true enemy. Sin is the true enemy in the church. And then finally, he turns and he says, and look at yourself, Timothy. Fight against sin in your own life. But do it, he says, what, with faith and a good conscience there in verse 19. But I like even better the charge of verse 5. He says, all of these things I charge you with what? With love. I know it doesn't seem right to us to put fighting the good fight or warring the good warfare with love, and yet in the sight of God, that is love. To combat the sin and that which besets mankind, which plagues us and pulls us to the depths of depravity and send us to hell, to fight those things so that men and women can go to heaven. There is nothing more noble than when people look at us and they see a life of war. That's kingdom first living. Chapter 2. Kingdom first living is a life of prayer. First of all, then, I urge that supplication, prayers, intercessions, the giving of thanks be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high places or high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. When people look at us, they need to see a people of prayer. When we put the kingdom first in our lives, when we are following the example of Christ, people will see us praying. Praying often, praying fervently, praying to the point of sweat and tears under distress even, that we are so urgent that our prayers might be answered by the only God who has the power to answer them. But what are we praying? Well, we're praying for the prosperity and the continued success of nations, of peoples, of leaders of the land. We're praying for those who are sick and infirmed and downtrodden. We're praying for the oppressed, that they might be redeemed. We're praying for those in poverty, that they might find their next meal. But verse 4 gives us a little more insight about what we're praying for. We look at verse 4 and he says what? All desires, or who desires, all people to be saved. Why do you think Paul put that in the middle of this context of prayer? Because evangelism begins with and rests upon a foundation of prayer. Just like we were praying that God would open the hearts to a Spanish community, I pray that God would open hearts to the Word of God throughout our community, regardless of race, regardless of their social status, regardless of where they stand in community leadership, but that all would come to a knowledge of the truth. And I pray that prayer often. I pray that Corsicana would be turned on its head. I love that phrase. I love to talk about Corsicana being turned upside down. To stand on its head. The reason why that vision or that visual is so unusual to us is we don't normally see people standing on their heads. And yet, if business is as usual in Corsicana, people are still going to be lost. So let's turn it on its head. Let's turn the world upside down. Acts chapter 17 and verse 5, when he said that those that have turned the world upside down have come here. And Jason has allowed them into his house. We need to be turning the world upside down. And it begins with prayer, brethren. When people look at us, they need to see a life of prayer. Kingdom first living without prayer is not kingdom first living at all. Number 3, verse 8 of chapter 2. When people look at us and they see us living kingdom first lives, it is going to be a life of order. Do you know people whose lives are chaotic? That everything around them, it's like Pigpen from the Peanuts. You know, there was everywhere he went, there's that cloud of dust around him. Dirt followed him everywhere he went. There are people like that with chaos. No matter where they go, they disrupt everything around them. There is no order. There is no hope for order in their lives. Everything seems to go wrong. Every step they take, it's that one step forward and two step back, as it were. But life is designed to be ordered. We are to worship decently and in order, 1 Corinthians 14:40. Order should be the commonness or the commonality of all, especially those who are Christians. Think about it. God designed the cosmos. God designed humanity. God designed His church, His nation. God designed salvation for fallen mankind. God is the God of order, not chaos. God is the one who looks down upon us and he says such things as, there are certain roles for men and women. I will that men pray in every place, in verse 8. Likewise, women be sober-minded and chaste. There are roles for men and there are roles for women. By design. In the opening of chapter 3, there's the role of elders and the role of deacons. There are roles within the church. God instilled roles and designed roles within our families, that there would be parents and there would be children. And it seems that when we don't follow God's design, our lives fall into chaos. Children become unruly. Spouses fight and gripe with one another. Churches have infighting because no one is taking proper leadership or they're trying to usurp authority. When we don't follow the rules or the roles that God has given to us, we fall into chaotic lives. And what happens with chaotic lives? Time is wasted in trying to scramble, to react to whatever situation comes next. There's no plan. I even like what Paul said. He says, I intend. You know what that means? I'm planning to come see you. But he had a contingency plan, didn't he? But if I'm delayed and I'm not able to, I write these things that you may know how you ought to behave yourself. In James chapter 4, he said, go to now those of you who say we will go into such and such city, we will buy, sell, and get gain. For what is your life? It is but a vapor that is here for a little time and vanishes away. What you ought to say is, I'm not going to make any plans whatsoever. I'm just going to take it day by day, minute by minute, and just react to whatever may come along. And if the world beats me down, so be it. I don't think anyone's James chapter 4 and verse 14 reads that way, does it? I think what it says is what you ought to say is if the Lord wills, we will go into such and such city and buy and sell and get gain. He says, keep your plans. Just make sure that God is in your plans. That's how we have ordered lives. And when people are living kingdom first, their lives will be in order. Not the fake in order that sometimes we as Christians fall into, where we want people to see our lives and think that we're all just perfect and hunky-dory and no problems ever come our way. Rain falls outside of our peripheral. You know, the sun is always shining. That's not us. That's not true Christianity. Christianity are filled with lives that struggle with trials and with temptations and lust of the flesh, that struggle with emotional issues of outbursts of anger. That's what Christianity is. That's who we are because we are people. That doesn't mean that our lives have to be chaotic. It simply means that understanding our weaknesses, our temptations, and the struggles that we're going to face, we plan accordingly. Are people seeing lives of order when they see us? If not, maybe we're not living kingdom first. Chapter 3, verse 14. Lives of godliness. Godliness is not just God-likeness, as some people define it, but literally it is to lose our mind and have God's mind in control of us. In everything. You know, sometimes we say, well, God is in control at church, and when I'm praying, God is in control. And if it has to do with my religion, then God is in control. But when I'm at the baseball field, when I'm at football practice, when I'm at work, as if we have these separate compartments that God is not in control of, and then there's the parts where God is in control. But you see, godliness is God in control at all times. If you want to say that your life is compartmentalized between work and recreation, between family and the times at worship service, if you want to say that, that's fine. And divide it up like a waffle, that's great. But understand this, God is in control of the whole waffle. Every piece of it. That's godliness. Notice what he says at verse 14. He says, I hope to come to you soon, but I'm writing these things so that if I delay, you may know how you ought to behave yourself. Great indeed, in verse 16. Great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. Where does godliness start? It starts with the foundation of the fundamentals of the faith. Jesus was manifest in the flesh, vindicated by the Spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in the world, and taken up in glory. The fundamental facts of godliness. Does everyone agree with that? Chapter 4, verse 1, the Spirit says expressly in later times, some will depart from the faith, devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons. No, not everyone's going to follow that. But Timothy, if you are going to live kingdom first, you're going to follow godliness. How is it that we follow godliness? Well, number one, it means that we uphold the truth. We behave ourselves in the church, which is the pillar and the buttress of the truth. The pillar is the columns. You think about Ephesus. Ephesus had the Temple of Diana. The Temple of Diana was considered one of the architectural marvels of the day. 127 columns surrounded the perimeter of the temple. Atop each one of them was a statue of a woman, and the frieze or the pediment would rest upon her head as the top of the column. 127 of them in the city of Ephesus that dominated the center of the city. When he said that you are the pillar of the truth, they knew exactly what he was talking about. He was talking about that which upholds the truth so that the world may see the truth. The buttresses were the sides of the building were often held up by large buttresses, which when the weight was placed on top of the pillars might succumb to being pushed outward and falling down. But the buttresses would shore them up and defend them against falling over. Secondly, if we are going to live godly lives, we defend the truth. As Paul said, I am set for the defense of the gospel. And what he says there in chapter 4, and beginning verses 1 through 5, in that area, he says, these people are falling away from the faith, and you've got to come in and uphold that truth, defend that truth in the midst of that. And then you need to exercise the truth. You need to exercise godliness, practice righteous living, purity before all. If you put these things before the brothers, he says in verse 6, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, trained in the words of the faith and the good doctrine that you have followed. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily exercise is of some value, godliness is of value in every way as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Paul says, I recognize there is a blessing to Christianity here, the abundant life that Jesus promised in John chapter 10 and verse 10. It holds blessings and promises for this life and for the life to come, eternal life that follows after. Exercising the truth in godliness is an important aspect of it. But also teaching the truth. Command these in verse 11. Command and teach these things. Let no one despise you for your youth. But set the believers an example in speech and in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Until I come, devote yourselves to public reading of the Scriptures, to exhortation and to teaching, and do not neglect the gift that is in you. Practice these things. Devote yourself to them, verse 15, so that all may see your progress. Some translations say, immerse yourself in them. Plunge into the work of God and exercise godliness. Not because you're in control and choose to, but because you relinquish control to God and He calls you to. Do people see godliness in your life? Kingdom first living. People will also see a life of respect. Respecting those who are around us, treating them with kindness and with encouraging words, uplifting those who are fallen, strengthening those who are weakened, fighting those who are fighting against the gospel, but doing so out of love. We need to be very careful about how we combat those things. But in this context, we are to respect those who are elderly, verses 1 and 2. Verses 3 through 16, we've got to respect those who are widows indeed. In verse 17 through 20, we respect those who are elders in the church. We respect those who are masters and servants. We respect those in chapter 6, in verse 3 through 10, we even respect money, understanding that the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, which many have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. We need to respect our attitudes or respect the power that money can have over us and hold it at bay. It's a life of respect for those who are over us, to those who are equal to us, to those who might be beneath us in a workplace or in school or other environments, that we treat everyone, regardless of the color of their skin, regardless if they're a man or a woman, regardless if they're fat or small. Makes no difference what their bodies look like, what their personage looks like. We respect them for the human life that they hold, and that they deserve the gospel. No one is so far away that God cannot save. God does not look on this earth and say that that person is not worthy of hearing my gospel. God wants everyone to know his saving grace. And then finally, as we turn back over to chapter 6, when people look at our lives, they need to see kingdom first living as a life of restraint. I know we live at a time when people like to be out of control. You know, it makes the big furniture sales. Oh, he's out of control. His chairs are too cheap. Or, you know, the cereal commercials, you know, it's out of control flavor. I go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. I lose it when I eat my cereal. Okay. That's not who Christians are. Christians are people who are in control, who practice restraint from the silliness of the world. Notice what he says in chapter 6 and verse 11. But you, O man of God, flee these things. Get away from the things that are threatening to tear your heart away from God. Run away from them. Flee from those things and follow righteousness and godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. Restrain your life. Bring it in and follow these principles, because these are the principles that lead to heaven. Flee those things, follow those things, and fight those things. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. He says later in verse 14, keep the commandments unstained and free from reproach. Don't allow sin to stain your life, to blacken it and cheapen it by giving in to the temptations and the lust of the flesh. Further down in verse 20, O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Paul says it was entrusted to me, the gospel, and now you guard it. You practice restraint and keep that word secure in your heart. Kingdom first living looks like this. Lives that are challenged by the righteousness of God. And he offers to each one of us the opportunity to read these and visualize them for ourselves. How will I look in a life of war? How will I look in a life of prayer? How will I look in a life of order and restraint and respect and control and godliness? How will this life look on me? And then, as Christ would say, go and do it. Go and do that. Epitomize that for those around you so that they may know God. You may be the only Bible that anyone reads. You may be the only person that can reach that friend or that neighbor or that coworker. And if you're living kingdom first, they can read your Bible and come to know God as their Savior. Possibly tonight, you've been struggling too long in sin. And it's time for you to come home. It's time for you to say, I can't do it on my own. I've tried it, and I've failed every time. Let God take over. Let Him make your life worthy. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to stand before Him worthy? Not because of what we've done, but what He has done for us. being baptized for the remission of your sins, God giving you a clean slate, a starting point of which to grow. Maybe you've fallen behind. You've already done that. You've already obeyed the gospel, but you've fallen behind, or you're being tempted or pulled back into the world. Come home. Be strong. Seek the strength and the encouragement of others who are putting the kingdom first. If you're ready to make the change in your life, we ask you to come while we stand and while we sing.